Oh, time holds still when I in awesome wonder consider all the splendor of this world.
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, the marvels of the universe display. Then sings my soul for all the mystery. Awake my heart, awake my heart. Then sings my soul for all the mystery. Awake my heart, awake my heart. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur sings my soul for all the mystery. Awake my heart, awake my heart. Then sings my soul for all the mystery. Awake my heart, awake my heart.
Welcome to WellSprings. I'm Rodney Wittenberg, and my pronouns are he and him. And it is my honor and blessing to serve as our worship leader this morning. Each week when we gather, even when we must gather at a distance, we light a chalice. Not only as a symbol of our spiritual heritage as Unitarian Universalists, but also as a call upon that divine spark within each of us, both emerging and eternal, and invite it consciously to be present with us here and now. After the chalice has been lit, we'll say the words on the screen. And together we say, we light our chalice to celebrate the path before us. The warmth of kindness that shines from within us, and the radiance of wisdom that is shared between us and never goes out. Good morning, everybody. Hello. Hi. I can see you. I see you. Good morning, and welcome to this week's online service. Our mission here at WellSprings is to be a community charged with the charge of the soul. And what's got me charged is not only that I can see people again, but more importantly, live music is coming back. Oh, I'm so happy that I will be able to go see live music. Now, I have to admit, my passion has always been recorded music. I love when it's done well. I love listening to records when I was a kid. And while I love hearing that vision that can be captured in a recording that is not the same thing as live, I miss live performance and live music. I miss dancing to really loud music in a sea of people. It is truly, for me, a spiritual experience. Whether it's orchestral music or a small ensemble, a punk band, anything at this point. I can't wait to go see live music. That's what got me charged. And the connection between the people there. And not to make this into an advertisement or anything, but as you all know, or some of you know, the band, the WellSprings band, will be performing live. And I'm equally excited to hear as well as play. So I hope to see all of you there. And I hope all of you are able to get back to those things that charge you fully. Again, for me, I can't wait to see live music again. I am so jazzed. Even though our community is gathering virtually right now, there are lots of ways that you can connect and stay in touch with us throughout the week. Right now, you can, on the screen next to me, right over here, you can see all the different ways there are to connect here at WellSprings. And if you're new to WellSprings, please fill out our online connection card to learn more. The link is in the video description below. And now, Jessica's on vacation, so here's Paula.
I'm Paula, and I'm filling in for Jessica, who's on vacation. I have two announcements. The first is a reminder that if you haven't done so already, there is still time to submit a vote in the board election. The deadline is this Wednesday, June 16th. And if you missed last week's congregational meeting, you can view the recording or read a summary online. Look for the link in the chat. I think it's that way. Maybe it's that way. Second bit of news is we have a surprise special guest.
Hello, WellSprings. Reverend Greg Pelley here down at the Unitarian Universalist Society at Mill Creek down there in Delaware. It's good to see all of you. I can't actually see you, but here I am. So I'm the lead minister. As many of you know, I am the lead minister at the UU Society of Mill Creek, but that's not where I started. Where I started ministry really was at WellSprings with you all as your ministerial intern way back there in about 2011, 2013. Anyway, I've been here 7 years, 7 years, 7 years of ministry here at Mill Creek. But it all started as a seed, as an intern with you at WellSprings. And the ministerial internship is such a critical part of our, of what we call our formation, of how we form a minister, how a minister begins to understand what ministry looks like, not just in the lovely, lovely abstract ideas of seminary, but really with real people on the ground, face-to-face every day. And my ministry really started with you all at WellSprings. It was a generous gift that you offered me to welcome me into WellSprings, to teach me about all the kind of unique and exciting ways that WellSprings approaches this Unitarian Universalist ministry. And it was exciting. It was a lot of fun. And I really, I kind of fell in love with all of you. So, you know, just to give a little hint at what the legacy of that internship was, one of the first things I did when I came to Mill Creek was to we entered into a process of creating Mill Creek's DNA. And that I took right from you all. Values, beliefs, and mission of WellSprings and that process and that work was so critical to how we form a church and how a church forms itself. And so my big experiment, could we take that to an already established church? And it has worked wonderfully. It has worked wonderfully. And we really work to live out our values, our beliefs and missions here at Mill Creek. I just have to say that the internship is just a critical piece. You had me as an intern, and it was a wonderful gift. And then you got Lee. So now, what I understand, you have a chance to do it again, to do it again. And this is an amazing opportunity. And I really wish you all the best in embracing this chance to be a learning congregation, to bring on an intern, to teach them the WellSprings way of being a religious community and a growing one, one of grace and deep love. So I'm excited for you all. And I hope this internship, this new internship, will be truly transformative, not only for you, but also for that new intern who will then go forth into our great world and lead from that sense of WellSprings, from that being charged full with the charge of the soul. So WellSprings, I have a request. I have a request as your former intern, as one who took your formation and brought it here to Mill Creek and have built my ministry here. I request that to the extent that you can, make a contribution to the WellSprings Intern Fund in order that you can fully support an intern in their formation again at WellSprings. It'll make a huge difference. Tell them Greg sent you. We'll see you soon, friends. Bye.
At WellSprings, the foundation of everything we do is found in the power of connection, making space in our hearts and in our lives for each other. This is the part of the service where we honor that connection by greeting one another. Now, we may not be able to hug or shake hands for now. I think that may change soon. Can't make promises. But there are plenty of ways to greet each other at WellSprings for a few minutes. If you're watching on Sunday at 10 o'clock, you can type a greeting into the chat window on the side of the screen. You can say, hello. Or you can go to the WellSprings Oasis group on Facebook with a greeting. You can take a picture of yourself and share a photo of yourself watching the service. Text a friend from church or make a plan to call them when the service is over. You can also join us for our online coffee hour at 11 on Zoom. The link for that is also in the video description below. So let's take a few moments now and say hello to someone. Thank you for connecting. I invite you now into our time of generosity, a time to reflect upon and express the gratitude for the role WellSprings plays in our own lives and in the wider world. Now more than ever, if you feel the value of our community in these times, we hope you will share a gift with us. If you have a smartphone handy, you can text WSprings to 73256. You'll get a link that will help you complete the gift online. There's also a link below in the video that will describe how to give. It's right down there. In these times, we can't thank you enough for the great support. Our offering will be greatly received. Let's pass those hats. We've taken the time to share the energy and connection among us and the generosity beyond us. Let us now devote some time to reground into that deep and soulful energy that is within ourselves. Let's take a moment to just be. Allow yourself to sit comfortably, maybe for the first time today. Notice your breathing and allow your eyes to fall closed if you feel comfortable doing so. And we do what is most simple and elemental in our lives. We take a breath. We inhale and exhale without rush or hurry. We breathe in and breathe out. There's nowhere else to go. nowhere else to be, nothing else to do than be here now together. We follow these words from Thich Nhat Hanh as we enter into our time of mindful silence. If we want to enter heaven on earth, we only need one conscious step and one conscious breath. Let us cultivate peace and experience presence in this quiet time together. Wherever it is that we are, whatever it is that we're doing, however it is that we are feeling, let us remember that peace and presence are always as close to us as our own breath. May this be so for you this moment, may it be so for you this day, and may it be so for you in the days to come, and may it be so for all of us. When we gather in person, this is the point of the service where our kids gather for their time of fellowship in Youth Spirit. But these days, Youth Spirit is meeting on Zoom every Sunday at 9 a.m. So for now, let's see if we have any shout outs from our youth in this week's Youth Spirit Yell!
Good morning, WellSprings. I wanted to bring you a Youth Spirit Yell today from the inside of my apartment. This is my kitchen. This is actually the exact spot where I stand when I have recorded when I've recorded messages over the last 15, 16 months in our online services. And I thought I would share with you my favorite part of my apartment, which is my roof deck, as our Youth Spirit Yell today, because this is a time of transition, especially for the kids and the teenagers and the younger folks in our congregation who are coming to the end of a school year. It's a time when we say goodbye to experiences and relationships and connections and routines that we've had for many months, and we welcome something new. I've mentioned a couple weeks ago that I am leaving this apartment after 8 years. I'm moving to Phoenixville starting on July 1st. So this roof deck is one of the things that I am treasuring in this last month before I say goodbye to my home here in South Philadelphia. So may you take some time today to honor and say goodbye to the things that you will miss as we come out of this time of the school year, and for many of us, a time that might have been isolating or closed off. And remember to make your goodbyes intentional and purposeful as we look toward whatever is coming next. Take care.
Bring them all in, bring them all in, bring them all in, bring them all in, bring them all in my heart. Good morning, WellSprings. It's good to be with you again. Late this past April, the president said something that none of his predecessors had said in more than a century. President Biden issued a statement explicitly recognizing the Armenian genocide that began in 1915 at the hands of the Turkish authorities in what was the old Ottoman Empire. I'm going to read you part of what that statement is because it serves to provides a frame for my message this morning. This is what the president said. Beginning on April 24, 1915, with the arrest of Armenian intellectuals and community leaders in Constantinople by Ottoman authorities, 1.5 million Armenians were deported, massacred, or marched to their deaths in a campaign of extermination. We honor the victims so that the horrors of what happened are never lost to history. And we remember so that we remain ever vigilant against the corrosive influence of hate in all its forms. Today, as we mourn what was lost, let us turn our eyes to the future, towards the world that we wish to build for our children. A world unstained by the daily evils of bigotry and intolerance, where human rights are respected, and where all people are able to pursue their lives in dignity and security. Let us renew our shared resolve to prevent future atrocities from occurring anywhere in the world. And let us pursue healing and reconciliation for all people of the world. We honor those Armenians who perished in the genocide that began 106 years ago today. Now, let's leave aside for a moment. I think those words are beautiful and powerful, and we might, of course, you want to ask the question, what's the deep commitment to that? Or is there a deep commitment to that? But just let's let those words stand right now, because I want to share with you the response from the country of Turkey and their foreign ministry, which said, "We reject and denounce in the strongest terms the statement of the President of the U.S. regarding the events of 1915, which were made under the pressure of radical Armenian circles and anti-Turkey groups." You kind of can see that right there. The recounting of a history, at least part of it, which most mainstream historians do fully recognize happened. And on the other side, the immediate condemnation and pushback that these words from the president, this recognition of genocide that no other U.S. president has done since the Armenian genocide, that it could only have arisen because of a desire to harm Turkey or by radical elements. On the one side, history. On the one side, a pushback to recounting that history. This is what today's Spirit Flicks movie documentary, actually, is all about. Spirit Flicks, which is our summer series here at WellSprings about the stories that we watch on our screens and the meaning that we derive from those stories. It's called Exterminate All the Brutes. It is directed by Raoul Peck. Raoul Peck also did one of the movies I preached on last summer, a movie based on the life and works of the late and truly great James Baldwin, the Black writer. Raoul Peck, who grew up in Haiti, or was born in Haiti, and actually grew up formatively here in the U.S. in Brooklyn and New York, and has lived at times on the continents of both Europe and Africa. His work, 4 hours, a whole miniseries actually, sprawling, encompassing, painful, and challenging. It is an attempt to wrestle with the reality and the legacies of imperialism and colonialism, white supremacy, and yes, genocide. He mostly focuses on forms of European colonialism and American colonialism here as pertains to the indigenous people, original people of this country. And he also does mention that genocide beyond just Europe or the US, that genocide is something that happens throughout human history. And he spends a great deal of time also analyzing the Nazi Holocaust as the terrible and logical consequence of centuries of oppression and centuries of believing that certain people are lesser inherently than other people. I believe at this particular moment of being alive, especially in this country, that Exterminate All the Brutes, which is a line that he takes from Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, which many of us know perhaps more famously was turned into Apocalypse Now and reset in Vietnam during the war. I think that Exterminate All the Brutes is the kind of history and wrestling with history that is really powerful right now, especially because we see so often the pushback to this kind of, I don't even like to say historical revisioning, as if it wasn't there in the first place. It was seen, it just wasn't acknowledged. It's more like historical reclamation, reclaiming what has been lost. We see in the pushback to this kind of more encompassing, more enlarging historical storytelling, the very reason why it's so important in the first place. In this country right here, right now, again, this was about the Armenian genocide that I opened with and the Turkish pushback against honestly reckoning with it. Maybe it's a little easier to see when it's kind of outside of us, but the reckoning with cruelty, oppression, legacies of death, and destruction. We see that when this encompassing, more inclusive form of storytelling kind of gets a foothold, how fierce the pushback is, as if it denies all the elements that have been valuable in our own civilization. Indeed, to tell a larger, more encompassing history is seen by some as a direct assault upon who we are, and seeming to say that if this more encompassing history stands, that somehow we won't be able to adapt. It is indeed, in the kind of not so helpful meaning of that word, a very fragile response. And in fact, there's all kinds of national initiatives and state bills and local ordinances, and I believe in one state it's even been signed into law already, that in fact outlaws the teaching of the very kind of historical re-envisioning, reclaiming that Exterminate All the Brutes represents. I think that this kind of work of being able to open to the painfulness of our past, to the death and destruction and cruelty, is profoundly, ethically, and spiritually important. Coming to understand the fullness of what makes us, us. And to recognize how these legacies of dehumanization continue to show up. And in fact, how the resistance to tell this bigger story is really about the inflexible holding of just one story. And so often, like it's often said, the history that's just written by the winners, and of course what that leaves out and who that leaves out are all the people who did not live or thrive enough to be able to have their story included in that larger story, at least not until now, as much as something like Exterminate All the Brutes wants to tell us this history, and their histories belong just as much as anyone's history. I mentioned that Raoul Peck, the director of this work, this sprawling, tremendous, vital, important piece of work. He also did a movie about James Baldwin, and it brings to mind for me, again, James Baldwin's perceptive, insightful quotes. They are, I think, too many to list. But one that comes to mind is this. He writes, or he wrote, "To accept one's past, one's history, is not the same thing as drowning in it. It is learning how to use this history." By one, he might mean an individual or a collective or a country or a culture. To accept one's past, one's history, is not the same thing as drowning in it. It is learning how to use it. To me, this is the most important part of committing to be a part of telling and living a more encompassing, more inclusive story. To do the work of anti-racism and anti-oppression. Because as we build that muscle, as we build the strength of that moral muscle, even something like Exterminate All the Brutes, which, trust me, if you haven't seen it, is painful to watch. But instead of turning away from the pain or denying the pain or saying that the pain will only lead to destruction rather than to a reconstruction, better ways of being alive. When we do this work, beyond just shutting down, something much more skillful happens. We allow ourselves to stay with the pain. My experience in watching this 4-hour miniseries that Raoul Peck has offered us is this, not guilt. I mean, there was pain as a white-skinned person. It's not easy to recognize the systems of cruelty that have privileged my own life living in this color skin. But it wasn't primarily guilt. It was grief, sadness. Deep sadness. To learn to relate to our own sadness as a reflection of our values, as Steve Hayes, a psychologist who I deeply admire and who's been a great teacher for me, is to learn to trust when he says we hurt where we care. That if we can learn to relate to our pain in loving and compassionate ways, then there we can find our values, and where we find our values, we find our individual, but even more, our collective resistance to keep on moving forward and toward the kind of life more suitable for all of us to truly thrive. I don't believe that pain in and of itself is productive. So often it's completely destructive when it's just re-traumatization. But pain that is met with compassion and open-heartedness, especially the kind of pain that comes from watching a movie like this, what it can do is it can open up a gap, a productive gap. The gap between the reality and our aspirations. And if we learn to live in that gap in a flexible, open-hearted, kind way, committed to the values that this movie points towards, as opposed to the values, if you can call them values, the cruelties that this movie exposes. If we can stand in that gap, if we can be in that gap, then there can be the possibility of growth and healing and a new way. One of the things we see in this documentary is how the very definitions of progress, inevitability in the 1800s and 1900s, actually progress is what justified those who committed atrocities against others. And so, yes, I, in so many ways, am a progressive, but I also know that in the name of progress, we can't just move quickly through pain or discomfort. And it's one of the things that this movie does really well, in addition to demonstrating the historical record, how in the name of progress, cruelty and oppression was justified. It also demonstrates who and what that cruelty looked like. Some of you might know, it's one of the most imaginative part of this movie. Some of you might know the name Josh Hartnett. He was kind of a, in the 90s, kind of a teenage heartthrob, good looking guy, starring a lot of kind of teen focused movies. And I guess he's still an actor. I hadn't seen him in anything for quite a while. But the way that Raoul Peck uses Josh Hartnett, who is white throughout this movie, is fascinating. He never, if ever, maybe rarely once speaks. But at one point, he is a U.S. cavalryman committing a massacre against the native peoples of the U.S., the indigenous people here. At another, he is an officer in the Belgian Congo committing the atrocities on behalf of King Leopold. And if you don't know King Leopold's story, the millions and millions and millions of people that he butchered and the millions more that he enslaved, all to enrich himself and the colonial era of Belgium. All throughout this movie, Josh Hartnett keeps showing up. And we see so often his body, grimy, dirty, covered in his own blood, covered in other people's blood. And we see how miserable he is in the carrying out this awful work of oppression. And again, I don't think Raoul Peck wants us to say, oh, look at poor Josh Hartnett. I think he's trying to demonstrate that systems of cruelty are immiserating. They create misery for all of us, but in very different ways. It brings to mind for me one of the people who has been a really helpful teacher these last few years in terms of staying with anti-racism work in a sustainable way. It's Rezma Menakem. Some of you know him. Some of you actually know quite a lot about him. He is a clinical social worker who, as a Black man, specifically focuses on the body and how it holds historical and racialized trauma. His most well-known work, although there's tons of interviews with him, is called My Grandmother's Hands, in which he kind of recognizes the legacy of how his hands look like her hands and how her hands were deformed by the grueling, painful work of picking cotton. He says that white supremacy is not just white supremacy, it's white body supremacy. And because Rezma Menakem is a profoundly generous person in telling the historical truths of racial trauma and gender violence and all other forms of trauma, he also commits to what is profoundly a universalist vision of wanting all of us to be healed and to be well. And he asks those of us who are white to look into our own collective histories and family histories as well, and see how the continent from which many of us have come was drenched in horror for generations, for centuries, and how many of us willingly or unconsciously brought that collective trauma here to this country and have perpetuated it. Again, willingly or unconsciously. This is what he asks us to wake up to, and specifically how it shows up in our bodies. It got me thinking over this past year about how one of my grandparents, my grandmother on my dad's side, arrived in this country. A long time ago, she told me a story that my dad has since repeated it, because I don't think I remember the first time I heard it. She, you know, emigrated from Tsarist Russia, but she really didn't emigrate. She escaped. There were stories about how the Russian authorities, in looking for Jews looking to escape from Tsarist Russia, would plunge pitchforks into bales of hay in case there were Jews hiding in it trying to escape the country. It's actually how my grandmother, at least in part of her journey out of Russia, got out, by hiding under bales of hay. I try to remember this history and what she must have experienced and what so many of our ancestors, under very different circumstances, perhaps may have experienced, what they were fleeing from. And I think of my own almost lifelong struggle with anxiety and an anxiety disorder. And it kind of has, and anxiety for me is a very embodied thing. I run fast, I run hot. Sometimes it's really tough for me to slow down. And I look back on that history and hearing that story and doing the work that Rezma Menachem and others have invited all of us to do, and especially those of us with white skin. It has actually, for the first time in my life, made me really, really grateful for anxiety and my anxiety. Because you know what? If my grandmother hadn't had an accurate threat system, hadn't had some level of anxiety, that her life was under duress and threat, I wouldn't be talking with you right now. So no, I don't like the anxiety. But now I can peer into it and I can see into it. Of a form of sensitivity and opening to collective historical pain. That yes, it does help to create me. And now I can work with it more skillfully. And this is just one small example of what Rezma Menachem and Exterminate the Brutes and Raoul Peck and all kinds of people are asking us to dig a little deeper now. And not to shut down, because the truths that we watch now being shared, we don't like. And so just push away. Or we say they're too threatening. Or we can't hold different parts of truths. What is most powerful and positive about the traditions that we hold? And alongside of that, within those same traditions, deep pain and cruelty and suffering. Again, like Baldwin says, it's not to drown in it, it's to decide how to use it. And so I wanted to end by going back to just a few selections of the president's words from this last April. We remember so that we remain ever vigilant against the corrosive influence of hate in all its forms. As we mourn what was lost, let us also turn our eyes to the future, towards the world that we wish to build for our children. Let us renew our shared resolve to prevent future atrocities from occurring anywhere in this world. And this, of course, is the furthest thing from easy work. But to be part of a community that is committed to playing a part in this work, to inviting all of us, always myself, ongoing included, I'll be doing this my entire life. I think all of us will, as long as we live, to be able to engage, to become part of a more loving, a more healing story. I think, in fact, there can be no more divine and holy invitation than this one. Amen. And may you live in blessing. I would ask if you would to please join your heart with mine in this little prayer. First, just noticing where we are sitting and how the spirit reaches us, how the breath reaches us right here and right now, from all kinds of causes and conditions that have created our lives, the helpful ones and the harmful ones, the skillful ones and the hurtful ones, the ones we would wish to hold on to as close to the beating of our own hearts, and the ones that we would now wish to release. And we recognize that each moment of this being alive is a choice. What values, what virtues, what helping, healing, holding ways of being do we want to direct our efforts towards? In small ways, sometimes in large ways, may our lives continue to move towards this beacon. Amen. And now is the time in our service where we extinguish the chalice that we lit earlier today. Although this light goes out, the light does not. And together we say these words. As we release this flame from its faithful service today, we allow the spark in each of us to burn on, to warm our compassion, to fire our delight, to light our paths today, tomorrow, and always. I'll hope to see some of you at our online Zoom coffee hour in just a little bit, 11 a.m. And may all of us, may we be safe, and may all of us, may we be well. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.